Our first scripture lesson comes from 1 Peter. Let us listen to the word of God. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring Word of God. Amen. Our gospel lesson, as I said, should be relatively familiar, since Bonnie spent 6 weeks on it. Now, when I was in preaching school, I was always told, never count on the congregation to remember what was preached 6 months, 6 weeks, or even 6 days ago. So let us try to listen to it with new ears, although we do tend to hear this one a lot. It is, of course, the story of the road to Emmaus. So let us listen for the word of God once again. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing them. And Jesus said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place in these days?" Jesus asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then Jesus said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So Jesus went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Dear God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. When Pastor Bonnie called, she told me she had done a series through Lent on this passage. She gave me some directions for this morning's sermon. Stick to the text of the day. Don't go off on tangents. My sermon should be about 50 minutes in length. Wow. You are a really faithful congregation. Maybe that was 15 minutes. We'll see. No politics, no matter what happened this week. So, with that in mind, the road to Emmaus. I was reading a post a couple of weeks ago on the internet. I get all my news from the internet, and I believe everything that I read on the internet. There was a study that had people who were given pictures and a series of four names, and they had to pick the name that was associated with the picture. Now, they expected if somebody was just blindly doing it, it would be about 25% correct. After they did the study, they found that the participants had more like 38%. So they posited that people actually will live into their name. If you are named something, that could have an effect on you. I'm not sure. My parents thought they were being original and biblical when they named me David. And I've never been in a class with less than two or three Davids in it. So much for that. That was considered, that 38% was considered significant. Now, we have names, and names are important, right? Well, we have these two disciples walking back from Jerusalem. One of them is named Cleopas, the other is not named. I would like to suggest for you, and I can't say that it's true, but I get the feeling that the second disciple was a woman. Why? Well, partially because women are not mentioned in the Bible very often. You get a lot of the women or the woman. You may know them as at the well, or the Syrophoenician, or Lot's wife, maybe. There have some other women in the Bible. The woman who was a sinner, a certain woman's message, a woman of Samaria, a woman taken in adultery. Now, I'd like to speculate a little bit, if you'll forgive me, and suspend your disbelief. There are two names in the Bible. One of them is Cleopas, and we've heard that name. The other one is Clopas. Clopas is a name in the Bible. Not a real character that you hear about, but Clopas is in the Gospel of John. Clopas' wife, Mary, is mentioned as standing at the foot of the cross in John. Here's the passage, and I'm going off on a tangent, so I'll forgive for breaking my first rule. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Now, maybe it's a stretch to say that Clopas and Cleopas are the same person, and they may not be. But people have names, and I wanted this disciple who was walking along to Emmaus, who Jesus came to appear to along with Cleopas, to have a name. So I'm going to call her Mary. Now, Mary, this wife of Clopas, was at the cross, and we just sang, "Were you there when they crucified my Lord?" And of course, had this song been written way back then, it was not, but had it been written back then, she sang, "Were you there when they crucified my Lord?" Mary could say, "Yes, I was right there down below." She was a follower of Jesus, a disciple even. She saw Jesus crucified, died, and buried. Now, asking you to suspend that disbelief, I think that we have two people walking on the road to Emmaus who, if they were indeed what I suspect to be a married couple, they may have been discussing things. Have you ever said that to the kids? I said that to my kids. No, 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 Mommy and I are just discussing things. If my supposition is right, we have a married couple engaging in this walk and a conversation that would leave people not wanting to hang out with them for the kind of anger. Now, these people have been through the disappointment and anguish of Good Friday, and it's now Sunday, Sunday evening, in fact. Something strange might be going on, but they're not where the action is. They're headed home. I make my guess that Cleopas wanted to go home. If Clopas, this person, and most of the male disciples, steered clear of the crucifixion, they may have been afraid to stay in Jerusalem. And indeed they were. As you probably heard last week, if you heard about Doubting Thomas, they were afraid for their lives. It's my guess that Mary wanted to stay. And that was the discussion. Now Cleopas apparently had won the fight. They were headed home. Some fights you're better off losing, as I think this one may have been. We don't know how heated this discussion was, but there might have been a couple of hearts on fire on that road to Emmaus. We know that these disciples could not see Jesus. Now, maybe Jesus was in dark glasses and a hat, acting like a secret agent guy, right? All right, maybe he was cloaked, something like that, so they couldn't recognize him. Or, I submit to you, perhaps these two people were so angry from their discussing that they couldn't even recognize Jesus walking right along with them. I don't know about you, but I find that I feel furthest from God, not when I'm alone, not when I'm depressed or sad, but I feel furthest from God when I am angry. There are these times that I just, it bubbles up in me or boils up when things happen. It's those times that I feel that God seems far away. But Jesus does what Jesus does when we're angry. When we're so angry, we don't want to even think about God. There's Jesus following along in stride. Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, the Divine Logos, Word made flesh, can conquer all anger. So what makes you angry? Failure? Injustice? What about poverty? Being let down? What about politics? Oh dear. How about being embarrassed in front of someone you love? How about being embarrassed in someone despise? We can be very vulnerable, especially with family, to conflict and hurts within the bounds of this family. And this was a conflict with the early church. The disciples through the ages have discussed loyalty and fidelity to Christ. What does that mean? There have been some terrible defections, including the not one, not two, but three denials of Peter, the number one disciple. You know, the guy they consider the first pope. When we only had one pope at that time. We weren't split off. We were all one church at one time. And there weren't that many of us. This was Peter the Rock denying Christ. I mean, these people, Cleopas and Mary, you'll allow me, as I said, they were disciples. They weren't just people who hung out a little while. They gave up whatever they had before to go and follow Christ. Jesus convicts them on the road. Now, he asks what's going on. Cleopas offers his story, his own story, in a worldly passion. He expected Jesus to be the Redeemer of Israel. Well, Jesus does the very kind thing and says, calls them idiots. You foolish people. That's a nice way of saying you idiots. He's giving Mary a t-shirt that says, I'm with stupid. Because they're still in this dark time between Good Friday and Sunday morning. They haven't quite realized that Jesus is alive and resurrected. Jesus opens their mind to the scriptures. I don't know how exactly that happened. I remember when I first figured out that Jesus was with us from the beginning. That's in 1 John. You probably talked about that Christmas Eve. If you read 1 John, Jesus was in the world from the beginning, the very breath of God. The Logos is considered the Word of God. The Word made flesh is where Jesus comes in. So Jesus didn't just start off being born. Jesus has been with us from the beginning and will be with us to the end. But then they get to this village. Now we don't know what Cleopas and Mary were doing in that village before they started following Jesus. But as Jesus is walking along with them, their hearts are once again on fire from listening to these words and figuring out who Jesus was and where they fit in. And we know that Jesus all of a sudden breaks the bread with them and they recognize him. Have you ever had that moment in communion where you may not have been thinking about it, but suddenly in communion, receiving the elements, perhaps you felt the very near presence of God? I know I have. It's one of the things that convicted me to want to go into ministry. Now Jesus vanishes, and I'll leave it to Pastor Bonnie to explain how Jesus is with us but then vanishes, because that doesn't seem fair. So I'll leave that. It's a cliffhanger. Yesterday I found out what a cliffhanger was. It was from Charles Dickens, where actually a person at the end of a serial was left hanging from a cliff, from Charles Dickens, and this is where cliffhangers began. But our story really isn't a cliffhanger. They run back to Jerusalem. Now, as tough it was traveling in the daytime, and remember they told Jesus, don't go on because it's evening. But at that very moment, they ran back to Jerusalem. And they have found out that Jesus appeared to Peter, who denied him three times. Jesus finds these people, even though they're walking away. They walked away from Jerusalem, where all the church was. But Jesus comes and finds us where we are, as we are. And Jesus brings us back. Now, there are times we feel angry, disappointed, when God seems so very far from us. But those are the times that God comes with us to comfort us, to walk alongside, to wait until our anger subsides so that we can remember whose we are, who calls us by name, who chose us. The road to Emmaus reminds us that Jesus is there walking with us, and that no matter where we go, God will find us. So I'll leave you with these words from our 1 Peter epistle. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring Word of God.